If you are watching this right now, you have signed up for the virtual portion of our First Communion retreat. So we welcome you and thank you for watching, and it's good that you're with us here. This video is going to be a virtual church tour. This is part of the First Communion retreat, and we thought it would be best to just record the church tour. And this is really kind of cool for you too, because you're going to get a really special, you know, one-on-one behind the scenes view of our church. So again, thanks for joining us, and we'll get started on our tour. I would like to thank Brian, who is our Associate Director of Faith Formation. He is operating the camera for me today. And so if you hear me say Brian, that's who I'm referring to. So thank you for bearing with us. All right, so we are going to start over here and kind of move our way that way towards the altar. So there are a lot of interesting things over here. You might not have thought so, but there are. I'm going to go all the way in this corner, so hopefully you can see. I won't stay over here for too long. But this little white box, hopefully you can see, there's kind of a plant in front of it. But the next time you come to our church here at Holy Angels, be sure to look out for this box. And this is just not an ordinary box. It's called an ambry, A-M-B-R-Y, ambry. And it holds all of our holy oils that we use throughout the year to anoint people in these different ways. So I'm going to take them out. And even just opening the ambry, you can already smell the oils. And so there are three different kinds of oil. We have here the oil of, we'll start with this one, the oil of the sick. And this is used to anoint people who are sick and some people who are dying. And so that's what this oil is used for. We have the oil of the catechumen, which is an oil that is used when folks are baptized oftentimes. So this is what that oil is for. And then this oil is very special. This is our sacred chrism. And this one has the best smell, and everybody loves to smell this one. So maybe when you come for your First Communion practice, we'll let you guys smell this one, because it really has a great smell. But this is used for confirmation. So when you're in high school, and even sometimes some adults are confirmed, you'll be confirmed in the faith, and the bishop will anoint you with this oil on your forehead. And so that's a really special time. And so all of these oils are blessed by the bishop at a mass called the Chrism Mass. And that is held always on the Tuesday of Holy Week. So that's coming up in just a few weeks. And then all of the oils are given individually to the parishes. So that's a really special thing about our church, is these are oils. So I'm going to put them back here in the ambry. So now this big object that I'm standing behind, this is our baptismal font. And so it's really this really big object, but we just have this little bowl, this little glass bowl in here. Let me lift it up like that. There's nothing in here right now. And when someone is baptized, whether that be a baby, sometimes children, and even adults, there's holy water that's poured into this bowl, and then the deacon or the priest will baptize the person or the baby with the holy water. So this is our baptismal font. This right here, this huge candle, maybe you've heard of this before, you've seen this in our church. This is our Easter candle. So we get a new Easter candle every Easter, and it is actually blessed and kind of brought out, every new Easter candle is brought out actually the night before Easter Sunday, which is the Easter Vigil Mass. And so this is burned throughout all of the Sundays of Easter, And then for baptisms, for funerals, for sacraments, a lot of times this is lit. And Father Howard in particular likes to burn the Easter candle as often as we can. So he likes to have a really big Easter candle. And believe it or not, last Easter, it was actually a lot bigger. I don't know if you can imagine that, but it's true. So it's already shrunk down a lot. And we're going to get a new one soon. And if you're worried about being wasteful, all of the candle, whatever part of the candle that's not used, is recycled and made into a new Easter candle. So the old candle does not go to waste. It's pretty neat. Now these are our presider chairs, our chairs. So this is where the priest will sit, whoever is presiding at Mass. And then this chair over here is smaller and is where a deacon will sit mainly. Or if there is a layperson like me or someone else on staff here who is leading a prayer service or something, that person would sit in this chair also. So only the priests and bishops and things like that will sit in this chair. So let's get into these garments here. I wanted to show you some of our liturgical garments. So the first thing typically that a priest or a deacon will put on when they are getting dressed for Mass is this white garment. And this is called an alb, A-L-B, alb. And also servers will wear this as well. And this is just a sign of your baptism and of service and of purity, this white garment. So this is what goes on first. Next, there's this strip of fabric here. And this is called a stole, S-T-O-L-E. Not like he, kind of like, it's spelled the same way as he stole something, but that's not the same as a stole. A stole is a symbol of service. So service to the church and ministry. And so a priest will wear a stole over both shoulders like this. A deacon will wear a stole just over one shoulder like this. And it'll kind of, theirs will connect right here. I'm sure you've seen a deacon wear it like that before. Sometimes they wear it on the outside of their, all their garments. So that's the stole. And then the last thing, typically that a priest or sometimes a deacon will put on, is called a chasuble. That's this thing. So that's the colored garment. And our deacons typically will wear chasubles, but typically priests and bishops and things wear chasubles. Deacons don't have to. And I'm going to put it on, and I want you to tell me what you see. So what can you see of me? Hopefully you just see my head, right? You can't really see my arms. You might be able to see my shoes, but you can't really see what I'm wearing at all, right? And that's the point of a chasuble. So the chasuble, when a priest is saying Mass or a deacon, you're not supposed to notice, you know, what kind of clothes they're wearing or what kind of shoes they have or anything like that. Really what they want you to focus on is the head, the head of the minister, the priest or the deacon, because the focus should be on Christ, right? So it's kind of so that you're not distracted at looking at, you know, what the priest is wearing. All right, so that was kind of this whole side of the church. Actually, before I move on, I do want to point out a few things over here that you might not be able to see, just so that we can do this whole side entirely. Over here, and actually next to all of the doors, the entrances to our church, we have these holy water dispensers. Now, because of the coronavirus, we're not able to have holy water yet, but these are our holy water dispensers that you typically would dip your hand in and make the sign of the cross as you were entering or exiting the church. Over here is our yellow, this yellow flag. Hopefully you can see that. And this is the Vatican flag. Every Catholic church typically has a yellow, this yellow Vatican flag, and also an American flag in it, which I'll show you. That's on the other side. And then over here, you might not be able to see it, but hopefully, this is our holy water dispenser. And again, it's real light. There's no holy water in it right now. But when things return to normal, we do have holy water in here. And if you have a little holy water bottle, maybe you'll get one for your first communion, you can come here and you just push this button and holy water will come out and you'll be able to fill your holy water dispenser. So that is, that's another nice thing about our parish and about us in the area. We also, all around the church, have these beautiful Stations of the Cross, and they're really, really detailed, and we have all of the pictures of the Stations of the Cross in our church here on our website, so go check that out if you're interested. We also have, we offer Stations of the Cross every Wednesday at noon, which you're probably not able to go to because you're in school, but during Lent, we have also the Stations of the Cross every Friday night at 7 o'clock. And that's also live streamed to our website and our Facebook page. So you can watch from home and see our beautiful Stations of the Cross. All right, now this is our altar table. And it's really, really large. And so this is where the priest will consecrate the bread and wine and turn it into the body and blood of Jesus. And that's what you will receive when you make your first communion. So this is a really special, special table. And you can see that there are purple strips of fabric like this kind of all around. And that's because it's Lent right now. And purple is the color of preparation and of penance. So we're waiting for Easter. So that's why there's lots of purple here right now. But first thing I'm going to do back here is take you to the tabernacle.
Okay.
And so this is our tabernacle. It's this gold box here, and it's really, really fancy. It's a nice tabernacle. And this is where the hosts are kept. So this is where the body of Christ is kept. And so on the front here, you might be able to see we have grapes and wheat. Wine is made from grapes, and bread is made from wheat, and so that's why we have that. And then on the inside, there's kind of two more doors, and we see an A, and this is like a horseshoe shape, and these are Greek letters, and they stand for Alpha and Omega, which means beginning and end, and that's one of the names for God. We believe God is the beginning and the end. And then in here, there's actually two angels inside these things here. You probably can't see those. And then in this ciboria, which we'll get to later, this is the body of Christ. This is Jesus. And we keep Jesus in here because there are times where communion needs to be taken to people who are sick, in nursing homes, people who can't leave their house. And so we have our priests and our deacons, and we have lots of regular people like me who will go and give communion to those folks who are sick or they can't leave their homes or things like that. So Jesus is kept in here. So that's one of the reasons why always when we come up to the altar, we bow because we believe that Jesus is present in the tabernacle. So moving up here, when right now we are not able to receive the blood of Christ because of COVID, and but we will be able to again someday. And when we do, this is called a chalice. It's just a fancy name for a cup, and this is what we use to distribute the blood of Christ to everyone. And so that's what this looks like. And then right now we're using, and I just kind of showed you this little bowl with a cover. And this is called a ciboria. And it's just kind of a fancy name for just a bowl or a plate kind of a thing. And this is what we use to distribute the body of Christ. And right now we're kind of using older ciboria because these nice gold, pretty gold ones, you really shouldn't use soap with these. And so, but we're not even using any of these chalices right now. But we obviously have to be washing things with soap right now, right? Because of the coronavirus. And so these ciboria, they're a little bit dingy looking, but we can use soap with these, so that's why we're using them right now. So that's that. We're going to move over here. So this is the incensor, or the censer, and this is used for very special occasions with special masses, funerals, confirmations, big masses, Easter, Christmas. Sometimes we'll use incense, and this comes off here. If I can get it off, there we go. And so you put charcoal in this bottom part, the same way you would put charcoal in your grill maybe. And then on top of the charcoal, you put what's in this little cup. This is the incense. And it looks like little rocks, just little rocks. But it's they're like perfumey little rocks. And you pour them on top of the charcoal. And obviously you light it with a match, and it makes this holy smoke. And so that closes like that, and then you can move it around like that. And so that is our incensor. And this is just a really fancy stand we have for it. Okay. Now this here, you've probably seen before. This is where all of our scripture readings are proclaimed for Mass. And this is called an ambo, A-M-B-O, ambo. And so our readings from the Old Testament and the New Testament and our gospel reading are all proclaimed from the ambo. So that's what this big podium is. It's an ambo. But moving down over here, hopefully you'll be able to see, this is our American flag. So we had our Vatican flag on that side, and we have our American flag on this side. So those will be typically found in every Catholic church. All right. Now, a couple last things I want to point out to you. All churches can be styled differently. So if you've ever been to St. Francis Cabrini, it doesn't really look like this church, does it? If you've been in their church, it looks very different, and that's okay. Different churches were made differently. This church is kind of a Gothic style, and it has this whole big, it kind of looks like a castle, doesn't it? When you kind of look up this big structure, it looks like a castle. And you can see Joseph and baby Jesus on this side. And then over on this side, you can see Mary, the Virgin Mary. And moving up the castle, you'll be able to see all kinds of angels. And then at the very top, you see Jesus on the cross. And you'll see other crosses up there. And lots of angels, and that's because this church is holy angels, and so there are lots and lots and lots of angels throughout the whole church. So look for that next time you come to church here. See how many angels you can count. There's a lot. And so this castle really is called a sacrament house. It has a really fancy name in Latin, but translated, it means sacrament house. And I think that's because we have Jesus in the tabernacle right here underneath everything. So that's kind of an interesting fact. Another thing I want to point out is this candle. Now, you might not be able to see this because this purple is really dark, but there is a candle in here, and it is lit. It's burning. And this is called a sanctuary lamp, and actually this whole area back here is called the sanctuary. And anytime this candle is lit, it means that Jesus is present in the tabernacle. So it means that the body of Christ is in the tabernacle. The only time during the whole year when this candle is not lit is Good Friday. And that's because Good Friday is the day that Jesus dies. So Good Friday and then Holy Saturday, kind of till the Easter Vigil, this candle is not lit. So that's the only time. Otherwise, it's lit all the time. So that's kind of amazing. So I have one last activity here, and then we will let you go. We thank you for being part of our church tour. So here, hopefully you can see, I have a glass of water. It's clear, so you probably won't be able to see the water, which is okay. And then I have a little cup of wine. Now, this is the same wine that we use at Mass to be turned into the blood of Christ. And so I'm going to pour. So the wine represents Jesus. Let's say the wine represents Jesus. And the water, let's say that represents us, because we are actually, our body is made up of mostly water. So I'm going to pour the wine into the water. All right. Now, you can see that I've poured all of the wine into the water, and they're all in one cup now. All right, now I want to try to get the wine back out of the water. How can I do that? Think about that. How could I get the wine out of the water? Maybe if I try pouring a little in here. Nope, they're still mixed. Well, that's because you can't. Once you pour wine into water, you can't get it back out. They're one liquid now. And that's just like us. When we receive Jesus, that means he's always with us. So when you receive Jesus in your first communion, he will always be with you. So I want you to remember that. As you're getting ready to receive your first communion, you're really getting ready to be united with Christ forever. He'll be with you in a very special way. So just think about that. All right, so now with your parent, you are going to practice receiving just an unconsecrated host. So this is not Jesus that you're receiving. This is just a simple piece of bread. And we're going to practice how to hold our hands together before you do this, okay? So raise the hand that you write with in the air. I write with my right hand, so that's the hand I'm raising right now. All right, now you're going to put that hand down at your stomach, all right? And you're going to put your other hand, the hand that you do not write with, you're going to put that on top. So your hands form a pillow. The hand that you write with is underneath. The hand that you do not write with, that's on top, okay? So hold your hands out like that, and the minister or your mom or your dad is going to say the body of Christ. He's going to hold Jesus up like that, and you're going to say amen. And that means that you agree that this is the body of Christ. And then the minister is going to put it in your top hand. And then you're going to take your bottom hand, the hand that you write with, and you're going to pick it up from your top hand and put it in your mouth. And that's how you receive Jesus. So backing up a little bit, When you receive Jesus at your first communion, all of the ministers, the priests, and everyone are going to come to you, so you do not have to leave your seat. So before you receive Jesus, you're going to hold your hands in prayer like this or like this, and you're going to bow, and then you get your hands ready. Remember putting that bottom hand on the bottom, the hand you write with, and the top hand on the top. And the deacon or the priest will say the body of Christ and put Jesus in your hand, and you will say amen. Pick it up with your bottom hand, put Jesus in your mouth, and then you can choose to make the sign of the cross afterwards or not. You do not have to, but you certainly can make the sign of the cross if you want to. Some people do it, some people don't, and it's perfectly fine either way. Now just remember, this piece of bread that you have today is not really Jesus. This is just for practice so that you know what to do. Hopefully that makes sense. And then eventually when you receive the blood of Christ, you'll just fold your hands like this or like this, and you'll walk up to the cup and you'll bow, and the minister will say the blood of Christ, and you say amen, meaning yes, I agree, this is the blood of Christ. And then you'll take the cup and just take a tiny, tiny little sip and give it back. And then again, you can choose to make the sign of the cross after or not. Either way is perfectly fine, and then you're done. Now you will not be receiving the blood of Christ at your first communion, because we're still not distributing that to everyone, but it's just a practice. So maybe mom or dad at home, you can practice with just a cup of water or a cup of juice, what receiving that cup would look like. It's really very simple. So hopefully that makes sense. So that is our church tour. We thank you so much for joining us. We hope that you enjoyed kind of taking a sneak peek throughout our church. And we look forward to seeing you next month for the First Communion practice at the end of the month. So we'll see you then, and God bless. Bye.